board. You got a prayer guide. This is in your bulletin. Check that out. And we give you some great things to pray for and some people to pray about that we're involved internationally. And so be in prayer for that. And I'm going to consider if you feel led to share an offering. A lot of new Christmas offerings goes to international missions. And God's going to allow good things. We'll share one little missionary a little bit later on in the service. And a couple of the great things going on there. We've got our Christmas families. The 13th is the deadline. We've got to deliver it to the American Family Sunshine Family Center on the 13th. So check that out. Participate. I know many of you are already planning to do that. We appreciate that very much. And also this morning, there you go. You got two things up here on the screen. One is breakfast. Steph, you got it decorated for today, cooking all up. And did a great job. And there were 24 there today. It's a big crowd and a lot of fun. And that's not our ladies' foreign exchange breakfast. That's Jim back in Turkey. That was our lunch out. We didn't realize when we went there that we had to catch our own lunch. So Jim had turkey for lunch. So he brought that. And we had a good time. Next month, I think it's the 15th. For our dinner out, our lunch out, we're going to go out at 5 o'clock, I think it's the 15th. It's a Friday night, we're going to go to the zoo and see the lights and get something on the way down there. So check that out. But we had a good time at our lunch out crew, which was this past Wednesday. There's your breakfast. And so a lot of good things coming up. And then next Sunday is dinner, Christmas dinner at 5 o'clock. Can't forget that. Bring your friends and family. Last Thanksgiving, we had a number of friends in the neighborhood and family come. We want to do that again. It's a great time to be together. So invite your friends and your family to come. We'll have a good, good time. So a lot of great things coming up in the Christmas season. And we can celebrate that here in Woodbridge. We'll have all kinds of. Alright, let's have a word of prayer and begin our service today. Blessed to have this Linda here, and we're blessed to have this Emily. She's going to lead us in worship. So good to have you here. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we love you and thank you for your kindness and grace that you give to each of us. We ask you to bless us as we sing your praises this morning and look into your word. Let us be your presence and let us seek to live for you in your way. We approach the Christmas season, Lord. Let us turn our hearts. Let us turn your heart around us. Focus upon you. Goodness and grace and just how you love us. For our precious name, we pray. Amen.
Good morning. It's so good to see you all. Our first hymn this morning is hymn number 95. Let me stand. Let's get that 95.
Thank you. I
comes here and not. We all know what he's done in prayers, he's down learning, he's got new jet, training others, keep our country safe. Leader's duty, so he's done all these works and prayers. Let me just share with y'all, we'll do our reels in just a second, but I thought, oh, of course we'll do that. Sanctuary looked a little different. All right, we appreciate everybody that helped and got ready for us yesterday. Buddy and Shirley and David Funches and Bonnie and Mary were here and Jackie and Joanne and Jim Beck and me and who else? Fay was here and somebody else from the community. Anyway, they have been decorating touch. Appreciate everybody doing it. They did a great, great job. Excellent. All right. I'm going to share real quick just a simple word from one of our missionaries. There it does.
Always.
All right. prayers. Some of the songs just start popping up here and there. And some of the channels just go 24 hours a day until all the way until December 26th. They disappear for another year. And but you know that we go into the stores and it's there everywhere we go. It's just all around us. It's all encompassing. And then, of course, it's the carols, which started today here at Brewery. We started singing Christmas carols. What do you think is the most popular Christmas carol of all? Anybody want to guess?
All right.
But Silent Night was the other one? I'll be home for Christmas. Okay. Well, of the carols, the number one is Silent Night. And in fact, Silent Night has been translated into 100 different languages. And so people love Silent Night. And I saw on the website it had all the 30 greatest hymns somebody wrote. And their greatest one they thought was Oh Holy Night. That's beautiful. I like that. And then they had Silent Night number two. And then number three and four were some strange songs that I never heard before, and which just goes to show you wherever you go, there's great hymns, but you can find them wrong. And then five, the Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Six was O Come, All You Faithful. And seven was O Come, Emmanuel. And I know it's not officially Christmas at Blue Ridge until we have our candlelight carol service. And which, by the way, is going to be on Sunday, December the 17th at 5 p.m. Put that on your calendar. It's always a special time. And it's not Christmas until we light the candles and we sing joy to the Lord. Now, of course, they're not only carols, but there's music that's just traditional, maybe pop music that relates to Christmas. You want to guess the oldest Christmas song that's not a carol? Anybody know? It's one you all know. Those I like Jingle Bells, but it's not that one. Jackie was weird. We had a musical production we were talking about at a church we served at years ago, and they would have a traditional Christmas story. We'd either tell just a simple story of the Nativity, or sometimes, I remember one time, we went all the way from the Old Testament, from the Exodus to Jesus on the cross. But they would do that at the end. First part, they would do just kind of contemporary Christmas stuff, and they did this oldest Christmas song, which is the 12 Days of Christmas. That is the oldest Christmas song, 1780 or something like that. England. Now, what are the most popular Christmas songs today that you're going to hear over and over again on the radio? What's number one? Okay. That's right. You'll hear that. You will hear that one. That's right. But now you'll hear All I Want for Christmas is Mariah Carey, the first part of her. And then another one by number two is Wham, Last Christmas. And then someone I don't think I know, maybe I know the first, it's called Fairy Tale of New York. That's number three. I don't know. And along the way, it includes some great touching songs. The Christmas song that's chestnuts roasting over the fire. Clarence often sang that. I'll Be Home for Christmas. I love that song. And then, as Buddy was saying, Shirley's favorite, Santa Got Run Over by a Reindeer. We'll hear that. Not Santa, yeah, by a reindeer. And then my favorite, Christmas Don't Be Late by that great group of Chipmunks. And then they used to have the dogs on. They would bark jingle bells. There you go. But as we walk toward Christmas, I thought it might be fun to look at some of the songs, not just the carols, not just contemporary songs, but look at some of the songs that are found in Luke's gospel that are Christmas songs. And today I want us to look at Mary's song. And Mary's song is found in Luke chapter 1, verses 46 through 55. As Mary sings a song to the Lord for what the Lord was going to do in her life and let her be a part of. So turn your Bibles to Luke, Matthew 1, Luke chapter 1, we read verses 46 to 55. And Mary said, My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in the inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but sent away the rich and empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said to our fathers. In her song, Mary does three things. Mary gives glory to God, and we see that today. Mary also declares that God is her Savior. And finally, Mary states her humble heart. She states to us her heart is humble. First of all, Mary gives glory to God. In verse 46, it starts, and Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord." Now, Mary's song is called the Magnificat. And it is called that because in Latin, when the Bible is translated into Latin, Magnificent means to glorify. In fact, that's really the first word. My soul glorifies. She glorifies the Lord. And magnificent means it meant to be glorified. And that is what Mary does in this song. She gives glory to God, isn't it? If you listen to those words, that's what she's doing. She's giving glory to God. In verse 49, she declares that he is what? Declares him mighty. She goes on in verse 49, declare him not only mighty, but he is holy. He is holy. And this song, in fact, is all about God. In verse 51, it says he has performed mighty deeds. In verse 53, she says he has filled the hungry with good things. In verse 54, it says he has helped his servant Israel. This song is a song of adoration and love to God. Now, just briefly, let me just give you the background story. The background story is in just the previous verses, chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. And God sent his angel Gabriel to tell Mary that the Holy Spirit would bring into the world God's Son through her. He would be the Messiah, the Savior of the world. And she was to call him Jesus. She received this message, and two things. One, she was overwhelmed with news. She was overwhelmed with it, but she also takes it with great faith and obedience. In fact, in Luke chapter 1, verse 38, her response to all this is these simple words. She says, "I am the Lord's servant." Mary answered, "May it be to me as you have said." And it says the angel left her. Now, she is also told at this time that her cousin Elizabeth, who was barren and who was getting on in years, was pregnant. In fact, the Bible tells us she was 6 months along. It was very obvious. It was not going to be very long. And in fact, she was expecting, was considered a miracle of God. And so what Mary does is that once she finds out she is with child by the Holy Spirit, and she finds out about Elizabeth, her cousin, is also with child, and is also a miracle of God. And so she just packs her bags, and she rushes to celebrate with her and to tell her the wondrous news. And as they greet each other, she begins to declare this song and begins to sing this song of joy. And begins to sing it and declare it. And as she does, she reminds us of who God is and what he has for us. And she sings his praises to him. And you might wonder, how would she declare something so beautiful as this? And the answer is very simple. And that is that she was someone of God's Word. She knew God's Word. In fact, if you looked very long in this passage, you would notice where the Scripture was coming from. In fact, the Scripture will you can find exactly where it is. You will find in the first couple of verses, she says, first of all, verse 48, says, He has been mindful of many. And if you look to the book of Psalms, in Psalms chapter 111, or 138, verse 6, it says, The Lord is on high, He looks upon the lowly, but not the proud, He goes from the fall. And you can follow your way through this, and you can see that she is giving examples that are found in the book of Psalms and in the Old Testament. And chapter 34, verses 2 and 3. 34, verses 2 and 3, she shares this. She says, My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt His name together. But if you go down a little bit farther, in verse 47 and 48, and 49, you find she says, For the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is His name. And then if you turn to the book of Psalms, Psalms chapter 71, verse 19, you will find that your righteousness reaches to the sky, O God. You have done great things. Who is God like you? And again, her song is full of songs. Now, how did she know these? She knew these from her home. She knew this as she was raised. This was the scripture that her parents had taught her. This was the scripture that she heard in the synagogue. And then, very interesting, there's another song in the Bible. It's found in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 1 through 10, and it's a song or prayer, a hymn. And it sounds much like Mary's prayer. In the song of Hannah, it says, My heart rejoices in the Lord. The Lord is my horn, is lifted up high. My mouth boasts over my enemies, for I delight in my deliverance. There is no one holy like the Lord. There is no one beside you. There is no rock like our God. In fact, you read all the way through those 10 verses that sound very much like Mary's song. And so when she had this experience with God and God spoke to her, her immediate response was to know who God was. That God is holy, that God is righteous, that God is powerful, that God is caring, and that God is deliverer. And that if God had this in mind for her, then she needs to receive it and trust in God. And she prayed. Sang a song of faith and joy. In fact, Mary was the kind of person that if you bumped into her, scripture would just fall out. That's who she was. And you know, one of the wonderful things is when you know scripture, you know what you know? You don't just know a lot of needless. I know a lot of folks that know all kinds of trivia. They can tell you all kinds of nonsense things. It doesn't matter. But if you know scripture, you know what you know? You know who God is. You know how God helps. You know how to get the help of God. And you also know how you need to respond. And so she was someone filled with scripture. And because of that, in her experience, she glorified God for all that He is and all that He does. And then secondly, she does something very important in verse 47. What does she do? She declares the Lord her Savior. In verse 47, she says very simply, And my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. She knows what God is doing. You look a little farther down in verse 50, it says, His mercy extends to those who fear Him. God is bringing mercy and redemption to those who do what? Who fear Him, respect Him, who follow Him. And to those who follow him, he is sending what? He's sending the Messiah. He's sending the Redeemer. In verse 54, it says he is remembering to be merciful. In verse 55, it says, who is he being merciful to? To Abraham and his descendants, even as he said to our fathers. She knew what God was about to do. What was he about to do? God was about to fulfill prophecy. God was about to fulfill a promise. You know, in Genesis chapter 12, you see the call of Abraham. God called Abraham to leave your country and your people and your father's household and go to a land that I will show you. He said, I want you to obey me. I want you to be my people, and I will make you a great nation. I want you to follow me. I want you to trust me. And when he said that, he said, if you will do that, which Abraham did, this is what I will do. Verse 2 of Genesis 12, he says, I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. You will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and especially this last. And all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you. It says, so Abraham left, and the Lord did. And he left and did all the Lord had told him. What God was about to do was he was about to redeem his people and to fulfill the promise that he had made to the people of Israel way back when. And the promises that he not only made to Abraham and his descendants, but his promises that he made to what? All the peoples of the earth. All of us. God was about to fulfill his promise to all of us. And he was about to bring that all to pass. He was about to bless the world through the one to be born. In fact, in Matthew, in the first book of the New Testament, chapter 1, verse 21, where God not only sent an angel to talk to Mary and tell her good news, also sent an angel to talk to Joseph. And Joseph took a little longer to take it in, but he caught it. And in Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, it tells him, she will give birth. Mary will give birth to a son, and you are given the name Jesus. Why? Because he will save his people from their sins. And Jesus, Joshua, same name, means Savior. God was sending the Savior. And so she praises God because God is sending the Savior. But I want you to notice here that she not only says and praises God, my soul glorifies the Lord, my spirit rejoices in God. And he says, what about? Not just God is a Savior, but God is what? God's my Savior. God is my Savior. And it's a personal thing. You see, the Lord is the Savior of the world, but at some point in time, you have the chance to receive him as your Savior, or to reject him as your Savior. I remember when Jesus was teaching, he was impacting the crowds and people were responding, and not everybody responded well, but a lot did. The crowds came, and even religious leaders came. And there was a fellow by the name of Nicodemus, and he came to Jesus, and he wanted to know more. And so he came at night where we could talk personally and he could ask him questions. And Jesus told him, in order to be right with God, you've got to be born again. You've got to have a new start and a new beginning. And Nicodemus didn't understand, so Jesus made it very simple. In John chapter 3, verses 16, 17, and 18, you know these verses. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And verse 18, and whoever believes in him is not condemned. If you believe in him, then he becomes your Savior. But whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only. Mary said, God is my Savior. I have placed my trust in him. In this world in which we live, we have to decide whether God is our Savior or not. Mary because it has no personal impact on you unless he's your Savior. I remember when I came across this verse years ago in John chapter 5, verse 24, it just kind of hit me. I just thought, this is just such a wonderful way to put it. Jesus said it, so that's good. In John chapter 5, verse 24, Jesus said this. He said, I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word, when you hear the word of God, you hear the gospel, you hear the truth, whether you heard it at vacation Bible school or a worship service, or you're watching a video of Billy Graham 50 years ago, or somebody sat down and read a tract to you, or you opened the Bible, or someone was talking about a Gideon Bible today, and you opened and read in a hotel and opened up a Gideon Bible and read the book of John, whatever it is, whenever you hear the word of God, whoever hears my word, however they hear it, and believes him who has sent me, you hear it, you believe it to be true, and when you believe something to be true, you act on it, you do something about it. And if you believe, that means you receive, you ask for forgiveness, you ask him to save you, you call out his name. The Bible says whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's what you do when you believe. You respond. And it says, if you hear and you believe, you respond, you have what? You have eternal life. Will not be condemned. All your sins will be forgiven. You won't be condemned. And it says, goes on to say, Jesus says, he has crossed over from death to life. When you hear it, you believe it, you receive it, then you have crossed over. You know, all of us living in this world right now, we are all dead men. We can all pretend it's not going to happen, but all of us are marching every day closer to what? To the end of our lives. I remember when I was in high school, I was a little kid named Long, and the week before Easter, he and a buddy decided to climb the side of the Sandy Mountains, and the rope fell, and Greg was at one point, Long slipped and fell, and his life came to an end. He was in 10th grade. That was it. I've known people who lived to be 100. But Greg and those who are in their 90s or 100s are all the same folks. Your life at some point comes to an end. That's who we are. But anyone who believes the gospel of Jesus Christ, believes, hears the word, believes and trusts in him, they have crossed over to something different. You are no longer a dead man or dead woman walking. You are going to live what? Forever. You're going to live to eternity. And the Bible says you won't have eternal death, you will have eternal life. You have crossed over. But it means that there must be a choice in your life. Over in the letters of John, in 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 and 12, it tells us that if this is a testimony, God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has a Son has life. He who does not have a Son does not have life. And so you have a choice in this life and the life to come. You can either live life with Jesus, or you can live life without him. And in the life to come, you can either live life with Jesus in heaven, or you can choose to live without him. And what did Mary say? God is my Savior. I know whom I trust in. She placed her faith and her trust in him, and God was her Savior. And thirdly, Mary shares her humble heart in this passage. Shares very simply who she is in this passage. She shares that for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant, which is her. She was saying, I'm humble. Now, she wasn't humble the way the world thinks about being humble. In that way, she was very humble. Her name, Mary, means Miriam in Hebrew. And Miriam, it's not a great root name. You know what it is? It's bitter. Nobody wants to better than. Why? Because she was poor. She lived in Galilee, which was insignificant. And she lived in Nazareth, which was an insignificant town in an insignificant region. She was unimportant. She was poor. She was not known. If people would look at her and she said to God, I'm humble, so you are humble. Nobody knows who you are. Nobody knows where you live. Nobody knows your town. In fact, if you were somebody, you weren't from Nazareth, you were from where? Jerusalem. You would have somebody that was important. But she had none of those things. But that's not what Mary's talking about. She was not talking about that I am humble because I'm poor. I come from an insignificant town. She says, I'm humble because when I care, compare my life to God and to the Lord, I know it doesn't measure up. We live in a world where everybody is so proud and so arrogant, and we just think we're something special. We are not. In James chapter 4, verse 6, God makes it very clear about what he thinks. God gives more grace. That's what Scripture says. God opposes the proud, but what does he do? He gives grace to the humble. He gives grace to the humble. In James 4, 8, 9, 10, it says, come near to God, and he will come near you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve and mourn and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and joy to gloom. Humble yourself before the Lord, and he will do what? He will lift you up. She said, I'm humble, because when I look at my life compared to what God is, I know the dirty, rotten sinner. I remember hearing about a story that O. Henry wrote. And it was a story of a young man when he was in school. He was head over heels with a little girl that sat next to him in class. She liked him too. But when they got out of school, he decided to go to the big city and he turned wicked. And he ran out of money, so he started stealing. And his whole life changed. And one day, after he lived there a few years, he saw that young girl walking down the street. She was still innocent. Vibrant and alive and pure and kept her heart right. And when he saw her doing you know what he did, he grieved because he knew who he was when he saw her. And he prayed to God, God, please renew my life. I don't want to be like this. When we humble ourselves and see that we're not what God calls us to be, not what we need to be, then we can be redeemed. In the book of Romans, it gives us the Roman road. It tells us in 3:10 that we're all sinners. In 3:23, it says we're all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It tells us God loves us and cares for us and died on the cross so we can find forgiveness. And if we'll simply admit our sin and call out to him to be our Savior, that he will redeem us and save us. We just have to be what? Humble. We have to look before God and say, I don't know the answers. I don't know the way, but I trust in you, and I will lean upon you. You know one of the neat things in this passage I was looking at, and that is that Mary was declared to be someone who found favor of God. In fact, in verse 30 of Luke chapter 1, it says, and the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. How would you like to be able to stand before the whole universe and say, today I know that I found favor with God. God looks down on me and he thinks there's something special. You know how you have to be, you know, the only way, you know how you become that? One day, be humble. Yield your life and your heart to God. And you do, God can do miracles in your life. In this little story, as the angel is talking, he talks about Elizabeth to Mary. And he says, I want you to see what's happening in Elizabeth's life and realize that nothing is impossible. The only thing that can possibly limit God is you. If you're not willing to follow the concern. Mary heard the voice of God and said, here am I, sir. Mary praised God. And lifted up her voice to God. She declared him to be her Savior, and she humbly yielded her life to him. And the world was changed. You know Jesus as your Savior? yourself. Your life is not everything you want it to be. It's probably because of those two things. You can receive it today. And you can follow me and know your grace and know God's grace. Dear Lord, we love you. We thank you that you loved Mary. We thank you that you used her and brought your son to this world. But Lord, we praise you that you want to touch every one of our lives. You want us to live a life that's worthy, live a life that honors you and makes a difference. Lord, if there's anyone here today who does not know you as Savior, Lord, we let them choose you today. And if someone who's gone on for their own path, let them start building again so that they can know your power in Christ's name. Amen. All right, at this time, Miss Emily will come and lead us in our closing hymn of invitation. If God is speaking to your heart, if you'd like to make a decision for the Lord, I'll be here in the front. You just come, stand, and stand. Next Sunday, we have our Christmas dinners. We invite your friends and family to that. We'll have a special time. And then our candlelight carol service is coming up at 7:30. And also, I forgot to mention, if you'd like to help beautify the sanctuary with poinsettias, that the little corn there is